Hello guys, are you, if anyone of you wants to check whether your screen sharing is working or not, just go ahead and present your screen.
We can start with the person doing it for group one.
Yes.
Harshit, can you screen share?
Yeah, hello. Is it visible?
Yes. Perfect. And are there any videos that you would want to check or any audio files?
Yeah, there's like I've included some video clips so I can check that.
Yeah, do that right now.
Yeah, okay. So is this visible? Like
yes.
So video, okay.
The audios, I can't hear the audio.
It's there's no audio in it.
Okay,
I actually removed the audio.
Perfect, great. Anything else that you would want to check?
No, that's all. Just the video and.
Okay, great. So Bhavna, would you want to screen share? Harshit, you can stop.
Yeah.
Okay, so ma'am, is my screen visible?
Yes. We can see the presentation. Any videos, audios?
Yeah, just one video.
Yeah. Okay, I don't think we can hear the
sound. The audio is not.
Before sharing, there's an option of share computer audio. I think you have not enabled it.
Actually, I muted the audio because it wasn't really required. I just wanted to show the gate.
Okay. Works. Anything else?
No, ma'am.
Okay, perfect. Ma'am, and all the presenters, whenever you're presenting, please switch on your videos. And it's preferable that the other members of that group also keep their videos on during that presentation. Please keep yourselves muted when someone is speaking. And guys, would you want the participants to ask questions after the presentations are done or during the presentation?
I think after the presentation.
Perfect. So what we can do is we can just ask all the participants, whoever has a doubt, raise their hand and we'll ask them to unmute themselves or send it in the chat box. That works. This will be after all the presentations are done. We can ask all the participants to do this if they have any questions. Does that work, guys?
Yeah, it works.
Okay, perfect.
Great. So we will be sending the participants link.
Yeah, we'll send the link now. Of course, I am sending.
Yep.
Hello guys, best of luck.
Nishant, I'm changing the chat setting.
Yes.
Please don't do anything. Please.
Hi guys, we will start in a few minutes. We're just waiting for the other participants to join in. Give us a few minutes.
Hello everyone. Please make sure that you rename yourself as your first name as and last name, or else the attendance won't be counted. Please rename yourself if any one of you have not renamed themselves.
Guys, and please rename yourself in the format that you sent your name to us in your registration forms. If you have your first name as the first name that you have entered in the form, do that. Please rename yourself.
Okay, so we'll start. It's 10 minutes past 6. Welcome everyone to Scomedipedia. Welcome to the webinar, first webinar of Scomedipedia. The first webinar or the first week is for CNS, that is central nervous system. So the series of webinar will continue for the whole of first week. And the webinars will be on Tuesday, that is today, Thursday, and Friday and Saturday. So today's webinar is anatomy of central nervous system along with the tracts. So we'll try to finish it in 1.5 hours. And this activity we are doing from so that we get to learn the basics of peer-to-peer learning, peer-to-peer education, as we are still in a lockdown period and we cannot go to colleges, we cannot go to libraries to study, and online lectures are not getting very efficient enough. So I hope this activity helps you and helps you in your exams and your future endeavors. So today's topic will be taken up by, first topic, that is anatomy of central nervous system, will be taken up by Harshit and Abhipsha. All the topics are being prepared by our Lumis. So Harshit and Abhipsha, you have the floor.
So hey everyone, I'm Harshit Piplani and I'm from the MP Shah Medical College in Jamnagar. And today I and Abhipsha are going to help you guys revise the different topics of the central nervous system with the help of an array of diagrams, videos, and GIFs, and all those things. So, first of all, I'm going to cover cerebrum and spinal cord, after which Abhipsha will cover the medulla oblongata and the cerebellum. So I'd like to begin with a quote. "The voice of the intellect is a soft one, but it does not rest until it has gained a hearing. There are no great limits to growth because there are no limits of human intelligence, imagination, and wonder." And with this, I'd like to kickstart the week of wits. Okay, so first of all, I'll be introducing the cerebrum. We have 5 lobes, that is the frontal lobe, the parietal lobe, the temporal lobe, and the occipital lobe, and also the insula. And we have 2 major sulci, the first of all, the central sulcus, which separates the frontal lobe and the parietal lobe. Then we have the lateral sulcus, which separates the temporal lobe from the frontal and the parietal lobe. And then we have 2 imaginary lines. The first imaginary line, which is right here, which is the continuation of the parieto-occipital sulcus. And then we have the second imaginary line, which is the posterior continuation of the lateral sulcus. right here, and this separates the occipital lobe from the parietal and the temporal lobe. And the insula lies in the floor of the lateral sulcus, and its function is olfaction, taste, and language. Then we have three surfaces in the cerebrum: the superolateral surface, which is shown in the first two diagrams right here, and then we have the medial surface shown in this diagram, and then the inferior surface. I'll show the diagram of that later. And then we have three poles: the frontal pole, this one, the temporal pole right here, and the occipital pole. Okay, now this diagram, the second diagram, is of the inferior surface. Now the inferior surface is divided into two parts: the orbital surface, which is the inferior surface of the frontal lobe, which is represented by the orange color right here, and the tentorial surface, which is the inferior surface of the temporal and the occipital lobe, shown in the purple and yellow colors right here. Okay, and also the surface of the cerebrum is thrown into several folds, which are called gyri and sulci. The gyri being the crests and the sulci being the troughs. And they help in increasing the surface area available for the neurons, which make it to about 2000 centimeters square of surface area. So we're going to talk about each and every gyri and sulci in detail, and we'll go surface wise. So first of all, there's a superolateral surface. Now, before I continue, I'd like to mention that I've taken these video clips from my college's own YouTube channel. Like my college's anatomy department, they made these videos and uploaded them to YouTube during the lockdown to help our students revise all the topics. So if you guys want to check it out, the channel's name is Anatomy MPSMC. Yeah, so we'll go surface wise. First of all, we'll talk about the superolateral surface. In that, I'll talk about the frontal lobe. So first of all, the video clip right here, it shows the central sulcus, right? So the sulcus present immediately anterior to this is the precentral sulcus, and the gyrus present in between the sulci is the precentral gyrus. And then we have two more sulci in the frontal lobe: the superior frontal sulcus and the inferior frontal sulcus, both of which run from the frontal pole to the central sulcus. And then we have three gyri: the superior, middle, and the inferior frontal gyrus, which are created because of the sulci. And the inferior frontal gyrus is further divided into pars orbitalis, pars triangularis, and pars opercularis, as shown in the second video. So the superior, the middle, and the inferior frontal gyrus, as shown in the video. Then move ahead to the parietal lobe. And just like the frontal lobe, the sulcus present immediately posterior to the central sulcus is the postcentral sulcus, and the gyrus present in between these two is the postcentral gyrus, right? And then we have the intraparietal sulcus, as shown in the first video. This is the intraparietal sulcus. And this intraparietal sulcus divides the parietal lobe into two lobules, the superior and the inferior parietal lobule, as shown in the second video. The superior and the inferior parietal lobule. And the inferior parietal lobule further is divided into an anterior, the middle, and the posterior part. Then we move ahead to the occipital lobe. In the occipital lobe, we first have the transverse occipital sulcus, as shown in the first video. This right here is the transverse occipital sulcus. Then we move ahead to the lunate sulcus, which is shown in the second video. This one is the lunate sulcus. So it is the superolateral continuation of the calcarine sulcus, which we'll see later on. Then we have the lateral occipital sulcus. I actually don't have the clip for that. And then all these sulci divide the occipital lobe into three gyri: the arcus parieto occipitalis, as shown in the third video. This right here is the arcus parieto occipitalis. And then the superior and the inferior occipital gyrus. Then we come to the temporal lobe, in which it's very easy, the temporal lobe. We only have two sulci: the superior and the inferior temporal sulcus, which divides the whole temporal lobe into three gyri: the superior, the middle, and the inferior temporal gyrus, as shown in this video. So this is the superior and the inferior temporal sulcus, which divides it into the superior, the middle, and the inferior temporal gyrus. Okay, so we're done with the superolateral surface. Moving on to the medial surface. Now, in the medial surface, we first of all have the parieto-occipital sulcus, as shown in the first video. This is the parieto-occipital sulcus. And the second important sulcus is the calcarine sulcus, as shown in the second video. This right here. So the calcarine sulcus extends from the occipital pole to the parieto-occipital sulcus. And then now I'd like you guys to focus on the diagram. First of all, this white colored substance is the cingulate gyrus, right? So and this right here is the corpus callosum. So the callosal sulcus separates these two structures, the corpus callosum and the cingulate gyrus. And the cingulate sulcus separates the cingulate, is present immediately superior to the cingulate gyrus, and it separates the cingulate gyrus from all the structures above it. And then we have the gyri. So in that we have the medial frontal gyrus, first of all, this orange colored substance. We have the paracentral lobule right here. Then the precuneus, which is the rest of this green portion, and then the cuneus, which is the yellow colored portion right here. Okay, now moving on to the inferior surface. The inferior surface, as I have said before, is divided into two parts, the orbital surface and the tentorial surface, right? So first I'm going to talk about the gyri and sulci on the orbital surface. So first of all, we have the olfactory sulcus, which is in which the olfactory tract and the olfactory bulb resides. So if you can see this yellow line, this represent the olfactory sulcus is present beneath these structures. Then we have the gyrus rectus, which is present immediately medial to the olfactory tract right here. This is the gyrus rectus. Then we have an H-shaped orbital sulcus, which can be seen here, which divides the orbital surface into four gyri: the anterior, the posterior, the medial, and the lateral orbital gyrus, as shown in the first video. So this is the H-shaped sulcus, which divides into the anterior, posterior, medial, and the lateral orbital gyrus. Then we come to the tentorial surface, in which we have the occipitotemporal sulcus, first of all, which is this one. Then medial to that, we have the collateral sulcus, which is this one, as shown, and the collateral sulcus is shown in the second video. This is the collateral sulcus. And then near to this, medial to that is the rhinal sulcus. And then we have the gyri. We have the parahippocampal gyrus, which is present medial to the collateral sulcus, this one. And then we have the uncus, which is present right here, lateral to the mammillary body. And then we have the lingual gyrus, which is right here. So with this, we are done with the gyri and the sulci. Okay, then we're going to talk about the functional areas of cerebrum. So first of all, Brodmann divided the cerebrum into 47 areas, and each of these areas have their own specific functions. So we're going to refer to the areas as we talk about the numbers of the areas as we talk about the different areas. So first of all, we'll talk about the frontal lobe, which is mainly related with motor functions. In that, we have five major areas. First of all, the primary motor cortex, represented by Brodmann's area number 4, which we can see in the diagram. So the first diagram is of the superolateral surface, and the second diagram is of the medial surface, right here. So this is the precentral gyrus, as we can see. So that's what the primary motor cortex is, the Brodmann area number 4. And it controls simple voluntary movements of the contralateral or the opposite side of the body. Then we move ahead to the premotor area, which is the Brodmann's area number 6, which is this one and this one. So it is essentially the posterior portion of the superior, middle, and the inferior frontal gyrus. And it helps in controlling the voluntary skillful movements and also in planning the movements. It commands the primary motor cortex to, it helps it in planning the movements and performing them. Then we move ahead to the frontal eye field, which is the posterior portion of the middle frontal gyrus. And it is the Brodmann's area number 8, which we can see here. It helps in controlling the horizontal conjugate movements of the eye, towards the opposite side. Then there's a prefrontal cortex, which is represented by the Brodmann's area number 9, 10, 11, and 12. It is also called the silent area of the brain because it does not cause contraction of any muscles upon its electrical stimulation. And it is present right here. The rest of the frontal lobe, the anterior portion of the frontal lobe is the prefrontal cortex. And it helps in controlling the emotions, cognition, motivation, judgment, and attention of the person. Then we have the Broca's area, that the motor speech area of Broca's, represented by Brodmann's area number 44 and 45, which is right here. It is the pars triangularis and pars orbicularis. And it helps in coordination of the muscles of the lips, tongue, larynx, etc., to help articulate words. Then that's it for the frontal lobe. Now we move ahead to the parietal lobe, its function is general sensory function. So in that, we first of all have the primary sensory cortex, which is represented by Brodmann's area number 3, 1, and 2, which we can see here. So it is the postcentral gyrus and the posterior portion of the paracentral lobule in the medial surface. and it is responsible for the perception of touch, pain, temperature, and proprioception. Then we have the sensory association area, represented by Broadman's area number 5 and 7, and it is represented by the superior parietal lobule, right here, and also the precuneus in the medial surface. And it helps in stereognosis and sensory speech. Now, stereognosis is the ability to recognize objects placed in our hand with our eyes closed. We'll come to that later on as well. Then we have the Wernicke's area, which is the sensory speech area, represented by Broadman's area number 39 and 40, which we can see right here. And it helps us in understanding speech and also formation of sentences and also in reading. Okay, then we move ahead to the occipital and the temporal lobes. So occipital lobe is related mainly with vision. In that we have mainly two areas, the visuosensory area, represented by Broadman's area number 17, which is right here in the occipital lobe, this one. And it helps in the perception of light, that is the color and intensity of light, and it only helps in forming the image, not understanding what the image is of. That's done by the visuopsychic area, that is the Broadman's area number 18 and 19. So that helps us in interpretation of the image, and it relates the image with the, correlates the image with the past memory and helps us in understanding, recognizing the people and the objects in the image. So that's the function of the visual psychic area, which we can see right here, 18 and 19. Then we come to the temporal lobe, which is related with hearing. So in that we also have two areas, the audiosensory area, represented by Broadman's area number 41 and 42, which helps in the reception and perception of sound and its qualities like loudness and pitch, which we can see right here, in the superior temporal gyrus. This is the auditory area. Then we have the audio psychic area, represented by Broadman's area number 22, which is again in the superior temporal gyrus, like posteriorly. And it helps in understanding the sound and correlating it with the past experiences. So yeah, we're done with the functional areas of the cerebrum. Then we come to the little bit of the clinical anatomy. First of all, we have aphasia, which is the inability to speak. Now, it is of several types. First of all, we have expressive or motor aphasia, in which there is a lesion in the Broca's area. So the person isn't able to express themselves. The person isn't able to articulate words or speak. But is, since the Wernicke's area is fine, the person can understand speech and form sentences in their mind. Then we move ahead to the jargon or sensory aphasia, in which due to a lesion in the Wernicke's area, the person isn't able to understand speech or form sentences. But since the Broca's area is fine, the person can articulate words, but they will be jumbled up. So the other person will be not be able to understand what, you know, he or she is saying. Then we have global aphasia, in which the person is completely mute and isn't able to understand or speak anything. Then the second one is the contralateral paralysis, which occurs which is a voluntary paralysis of the contralateral side, occurs due to the lesion in the primary motor area, which is the Broadman's area number 4. And if there are iterative lesions in that area, it can even lead to Jacksonian epilepsy, fits, that is convulsions. Then we move to apraxia, which is the inability to perform skilled movements. So if you remember, that would obviously be due to the lesion in the premotor area number, Broadman's area number 6. And then we have agraphia, which is the inability to write. And then there's the frontal eye field lesion. In this, there will be a lesion in the frontal eye field, which is represented by Broadman's area number 8. In this, the eyes permanently get moved to the same side as the lesion, and they cannot be voluntarily moved to the opposite side. But they will move involuntarily if there's an object crossing the person's field of vision. I'm sorry, I think someone's mic is on. Can they turn it off?
Are we looking into it?
Okay. Thank you. Okay, so moving ahead. Yeah, as I said, if there's a frontal eye field lesion, the person cannot voluntarily move their eyes to the opposite side, but the eyes will move involuntarily if there's an object crossing the person's field of vision. Then we have the lesion of the primary sensory cortex, which you already saw. Then another important clinical anatomy is agnosia, which is the inability to recognize objects or people. It is also of several types. So it will mainly happen because of lesions in the association areas. So first of all, we have tactile agnosia or asteriognosis, which occurs due to a lesion in the sensory association area, which is the Broadman's area number 5 and 7. In this, the person isn't able to recognize objects based on touch. Like as we discussed, stereognosis is the ability to recognize objects based on touch with their eyes closed. So if there's a lesion in the sensory association area, the person won't be able to do that. Then we have visual agnosia, in which there's a lesion in the visual association area or the visual psychic area, the Brodmann's area number 18 and 19. And in this, the person isn't able to recognize people or objects when they see them. Then we have auditory agnosia, in which there's a lesion in the auditory association area or the audio psychic area, which is the Brodmann's area number 22. And the person isn't able to recognize sounds due to this lesion. Okay, now we finally talk about the white matter of cerebrum. So this in the cerebrum, the gray matter is outside and the white matter is inside. So the white matter essentially helps us in connecting the gray matter, the different areas of gray matter with one another, and also to connect the gray matter with other parts of the CNS. So the fibers are classified into three parts, the association or the arcuate fibers. They're further divided into two parts, the long and the short association fibers. Then the commissural fibers, that is like the corpus callosum, which connect the two cerebral hemispheres. And corpus callosum is the largest one of them. And the projection fibers, finally, which essentially constitute the internal capsule. So that's it for cerebrum. We now move ahead to the spinal cord. Okay, so first of all, the spinal cord is continuous with the medulla oblongata, and it extends from the level of C1 to the level of L1, as we can see in the diagram right here. So that's the length of the spinal cord, and it is about 45 centimeters in length in males and 42 centimeters in length in females. But the vertebral column is 65 centimeters in length, about 65 centimeters. So we can clearly see that the spinal cord does not exactly correlate with each and every does not correlate with the vertebral column, and it is smaller. Now below the level of L1, the spinal cord continues in the form of conus medullaris, which has a tapering end, which we can see right here. This blue and red colored thing is the conus medullaris, and it gives origin to two types of spinal nerves, that is the lumbar and the spinal sacral spinal nerves, which together constitute the cauda equina, which we know is basically the horse's tail. That's why lumbar puncture is done below the level of L2, as we saw, the spinal cord is only till the level of L1. So if lumbar puncture is done below the level of L2, the chances of injuring the spinal cord are essentially zero. Now, below the level of conus medullaris, only the pia mater continues in the form of a thin fibrous cord called the phylum terminal, as we can see right here. This black colored line is the phylum terminal, which then gets connected to the coccyx. Then the spinal segments. Now, as I already mentioned, the spinal cord is 20 centimeters shorter than the vertebral column, which is about 65 centimeters in length, the vertebral column, I mean. So obviously the spinal segments don't lie exactly opposite to their corresponding vertebral segments. And these are the vertebral levels corresponding to the spinal segments. Then we talk about the enlargements. Now, the spinal cord has two major enlargements, which are the enlargements are present to accommodate the neurons which supply the upper and the lower limb. So we'll have two enlargements. First will be the cervical enlargement, which supplies the upper limb, and it extends from the level of C5 to T1, this one. And then the lumbar enlargement, which supplies the lower limb, and it extends from the level of L2 to S3, which is this one. Okay, then we talk about the external features of the spinal cord. Now, there are mainly two fissures, or you could say sulci. The first one is along the midline in the anterior surface, called the anterior median fissure. And it is a deep separation, as we can see. Then we have along the posterior surface, we have the posterior median fissure, this one, which is flanked on both the sides by the posterolateral sulcus, this one. Okay. Then finally, we talk about the internal features of the spinal cord. Now, unlike the cerebrum, which had gray matter outside and white matter inside, in the spinal cord, white matter lies outside and gray matter lies inside. So the gray matter lies inside in the form of a H-shaped gray, in the form of an H shape, which we can see in the second diagram. This is the H-shaped gray matter, which consists of neuronal cell bodies, while the white matter is present outside in the form of myelinated neuronal axons. This one, the white colored substance around it is the white matter. Now the ventral or the anterior horns of the gray matter, this one, they contain the cell bodies of motor neurons, whereas the dorsal or the posterior horn contains the cell bodies receiving sensory information. So this is the posterior horn, this is the anterior horn. Okay. So, and each and every spinal nerve, it arises by a series of dorsal or ventral nerve rootlets. And these rootlets unite in or near the intervertebral foramen to form the spinal nerve. As you can see in this diagram, the rootlets are combining to form the spinal nerves. And the spinal nerves, in total, there are 31 pairs of spinal nerves. Spinal nerves are, of course, both for left and right, so they're in pairs. So we have 31 pairs of spinal nerves. And there are 8 cervical, 12 thoracic, 5 lumbar and 5 sacral, and 1 coccygeal spinal nerve, pairs of spinal nerves, making it the total to 31. Finally, we'll talk about the clinical anatomy of the spinal cord. So the first one is the conus medullaris syndrome, which occurs due to injury in the S2, S3 and S4 segments of the spinal cord. So that leads to the anesthesia in the perineum, including the bladder, and it also disrupts the sexual functions as the same nerves carry out these functions. Then the second one is the cauda equina syndrome. Now, as we know, the cauda equina is made up of the lumbar and the sacral spinal nerves. So damage to that will lead to a lower motor neuron paralysis in the lower limbs. And one of the characteristic features of this is root pains. Then we move ahead to the poliomyelitis, which occur. It is a viral disease that affects the anterior horn cell. So it leads to flaccid paralysis of the affected segments. It is also a type of a lower motor neuron paralysis. Now, if polio affects the upper cervical segments like C4, then that can be fatal because the C4 segment supplies the diaphragm. So if there's a paralysis of the diaphragm, the person won't be able to breathe and it can be therefore fatal. Then we have tabs dorsalis, which occurs during the tertiary stage of syphilis. Now, in this, there are degenerative lesions of the dorsal nerve roots and of the posterior white columns, and the features of this disease are severe pain in lower limbs. Okay. So, yeah, thanks everyone for lending me your ears. Now, Abhipsha will talk about the cerebellum and the medulla oblongata.
Thank you for that introduction. It was very concise and very nice, Harshit. So I'm Abhipsha Acharya and I'm from MGM Medical College, and I will be taking up cerebellum and medulla oblongata for you. I will try to make it as concise as possible and go over most of the important things. Next.
Is the screen being shared?
Yeah, it's being shared. I can see it.
Okay, one second. Okay.
So when we speak about the external features of the cerebellum, they can largely be studied under 3 of these subheadings. So before that, I'd like to begin by saying that the cerebellum has these 2 large lateral hemispheres, and these are called cerebellar hemispheres. And in between them, we'll see this thing called the vermis, which is worm-like. Now, even the vermis on the topmost part is called the superior vermis, and at the bottom is called the inferior vermis. So this is there. Along with that, we study it under 2 surfaces, superior surface and the inferior surface. Just so you know, the inferior surface is a deep notch called valencula. And there are 2 notches, anterior cerebellar notch and posterior cerebellar notch, 3 fissures, horizontal fissure, posterolateral fissure, and fissura prima. So here we have this diagram that very nicely illustrates the features of the cerebellum according to me. So the topmost diagram is the superior surface and the one at the bottom is the inferior surface. Over here, we can see that the anterior cerebellar notch is right at the top and the posterior cerebellar notch is at the bottom. Along with this, we are also able to see the primary fissure, the demarcation between the red and the green area, and the horizontal fissure is located on the green area. As you can see, there's no fissura prima over here, but hold that thought. I will get back to you for that. It's kind of important about what we're going to study after this. And we can, of course, even see the vermis. Next. Now, when we talk about the subdivisions of the cerebellum, they can be studied under 2 headings. One is the anatomical subdivision and one is the morphological subdivision. So anatomically, there's anterior lobe, posterior lobe, and floccular nodular lobe. But when we speak about morphological, that's a different classification altogether. So there's vestibular cerebellum, which is called the archicerebellum. The reason being, it's the oldest part of the cerebellum. It's archaic, therefore we say it's old. We have the spinal cerebellum, which is the paleocerebellum, and the cerebral cerebellum, which is neocerebellum. Now, you should know that the neocerebellum is essentially the most well-developed in man. And this is actually what differentiates humans from lesser mammals, from the evolutionary perspective. It also makes up the biggest chunk of the cerebellum. Can you go to the diagram? Yeah. So I feel like this diagram, we can see this, color demarcation. The yellow part is the anterior lobe. The green part, the large bottom part, is the posterior lobe. And the floccular nodular lobe is right at the bottom. It's very tiny and it's essentially...
Abhipra, I think you're covering your mic. We have lost audio. I think it's working right now. You can just continue.
Am I audible?
Yes, perfect.
So go to the next diagram. Now here, this is a morphological subdivision of the cerebellum. Over here, we can see that essentially the vestibular cerebellum that I spoke about, that only includes the floccular nodular lobe, which is right at the bottom. You can see the skin-colored portion at the bottom. This is the vestibular cerebellum. The spinal cerebellum includes the vomus and the intermediate zone of the hemispheres. So that is the central pink portion, and the intermediate zone is what you saw between the dotted lines in the previous diagram. This is purple. Now, along with that, we can see the cerebellum. And again, I said this is the majority of the portion. It's the lateral zone of the hemisphere on either ends. So I think this is the morphological subdivisions in a nutshell. Please go ahead. Okay, internal structure. So like all structures, internal structures in the CNS, there's gray matter and there's white matter. So the gray matter can also be broken further into cerebellar cortex and the intracerebellar nuclei. In the cerebellar cortex, there are three different types of cells that we see. And there are three different layers. The outer molecular layer, this contains the basket cells and the stellate cells. It's also called the plexiform layer. The intermediate Purkinje layer, this contains a single row of flower-shaped cells. These cells are called Purkinje cells. And these essentially synapse with collaterals from the basket cells, axons, and the climbing fibers. The inner granular layer, this contains small granule cells, thus the name. And it also has large Golgi cells. So this is an identification feature for the inner granular layer, the Golgi cells, which are prominent, yet they are scanty. And then we talk about the intracerebellar nuclei. There's dentate nucleus, globose nucleus, and fastigial nucleus. Now, the dentate nucleus will come into play a little while later. I'll show you how that happens. In the white matter, we have the intrinsic fibers. Next. Okay. Yeah, here we have a histology diagram of the cerebellum. We have the meninges in the outermost layer, the molecular layer, the granular layer, and the white matter. Even though this kind of does the job, it does miss out one layer. So I've got another diagram for that. Please go next. Yes, and even though this isn't the histology diagram that they require you to draw in the exams, this pretty much does the job. You can see the demarcation, molecular layer, single layer of thin Purkinje layer, and the granular layer. You can see it's filled with granules and the white matter right on the inside. Next. Okay, now here comes the cerebellar connections. As we see, when we talk about the connection of the cerebellum, there are either afferent fibers or there are efferent fibers. So with afferent fibers, these are fibers that are coming from different areas and reaching the cerebellum. with the efferent fibers, they are going from the cerebellum to different places. Now, what happens in the afferent fibers is that we see these names are very big and they're very long, and honestly speaking, it's very intimidating for me. But then I realized the only way to do it is to actually study brainstem properly. So there's cortico-ponto-cerebellar fiber. So this is coming from the cerebral cortex, moving on to the pons, and then going to the cerebellum. Then we have the cerebro-olivo-cerebellar, which is from the cerebrum to the olives to the cerebellum. And the cerebello-reticulocerebellar is from the cerebellum, reticular formation to the cerebellum. And here we have fibers from the spinal cord. Now, this is something I will not go into for details because you're going to do it next in the tracts part. The afferent fibers are of two types. Remember, climbing fibers, inferior olivary nucleus, and mossy fibers, they help in rosette formation and ultimately form the cerebellar glomerulus. And the efferent fibers, they pass to red nucleus and they help in reticular formation. And again, these are essentially important for muscle tone. Next. Yeah. Now I have this diagram for everyone to sort of clearly understand how the fibers can go from the cell. You see the frontal lobe on the right and the temporal lobe on the left. So they actually go from the frontal lobe and travel all the way down and ultimately reach the cerebellum to the respective areas. So this is just for you to understand how the fibers are going. So it illustrates that well. Next. Now we'll talk about the cerebellar peduncles. Again, this looks very intimidating, but this can also be easily broken down and understood. So there are three different cerebellar peduncles. There's inferior cerebellar peduncle, middle cerebellar peduncle, and the superior cerebellar peduncle. In each of these cases, we see afferent fibers that are coming from somewhere else and reaching the cerebellum, and efferent fibers coming from the cerebellum and moving to other areas. And over here, we can see, again, posterior spinocerebellar fibers are coming from the posterior part of the spinal cord. Olivocerebellar is coming from the olives to the cerebellum. Paraolivocerebellar is from an area right next to the olives. Then there's cuneocerebellar, anterior external arcuate fibers, vestibulocerebellar, and reticulocerebellar fibers. When we talk about efferent, the cerebello-vestibular fibers and the cerebello-reticular and the cerebello-olivary. So if you can actually understand, if you actually look at it, you will know that the efferent fibers are the reverse of the afferent fibers. There are three of those names that are simply common. So if you've been asked to list them, you can always have that at the back of your head. It'll get easier. When we talk about the afferent fibers, there's pontocerebellar in the middle cerebellar peduncle. They are coming from the pons ending at the cerebellum, reticulocerebellar, and ceratogenic fibers essentially contain serotonin. Another thing that you should know is that the efferent, there are no efferent fibers in the middle cerebellar peduncle. And the reason I'm telling you this is because often they might just put an MCQ to confuse you and you'll keep thinking, oh no, there must be some fiber. No, there's no fiber. Just remember that there are none. Then there's superior cerebellar peduncle. Here we see anterior spinocerebellar tract coming from the anterior portion of the spinal cord, the tectocerebellar, trigeminocerebellar, which is in correlation with the trigeminal nerve, ceruleocerebellar fibers, and the hypothalamocerebellar fibers. Now, these come from the hypothalamus and terminate at the cerebellum. With the efferent fibers, we can see cerebellorubral fibers, dentatorubral, or dentatothalamic. I spoke about the dentate nucleus in the internal structure. So this is with respect to that, cerebellorolivary and cerebelloreticular fibers. Next. I just mentioned the names, but here we have a diagram to sort of look at how it is present in the cerebellum. We see the superior the superior peduncle is right on the top. The inferior cerebellum is a little below that, and the middle cerebellum is on the middle. And the reason I'm showing you this is you can see how the pons and how the olives, everything is so closely located, and the fibers are essentially moving from here in that area. So you can sort of get in your head, you know. Next. When we talk about the arterial supply of the cerebellum, it has only three arterial supply, that is superior cerebellar artery, anterior inferior cerebellar artery, posterior inferior cerebellar artery, and a diagram to show the same. Yeah, there are multiple superior cerebellar arteries.
posterior inferior cerebellar and anterior inferior cerebellar. As you can see, it's this is posteriorly and this is located anteriorly. And over here, we actually also see the basilar artery and the vertebral artery. Now, this is going to come into play a little later when I go into medulla oblongata. Next. Now, the functions of the cerebellum is maintenance of posture, maintenance of muscle tone, and coordination of voluntary motor activity. There's also something called as a comparator function. And this is, to illustrate this to you, I'll explain. The cerebellum compares the intended movement with the actual movement occurring. And in case of discrepancy, a signal is sent to motor cortex and lower motor neurons corrected. So this helps in learning motor skills. Now I have this bottle in front of me. I have kept it over here. I want to pick up the bottle and bring it close to me. So I will push my hand forward, grasp the bottle, and take it towards me. But often, not often, but what happens is if my hand, instead of going forward, it moves backward, I won't be able to pick up the bottle. So this is when there's a discrepancy between the actual movement and the intended movement. In such situations, cerebellum's comparator function will come into being and correct this. Next. Now, before I move into the applied anatomy, I thought this case very nicely demonstrates how you would understand the disease. So we have Mrs. A, who is aged 20 years old. She has inability to walk independently since she was 10 years old. She has difficulty maintaining balance while standing and doing daily activities. She has difficulty in fine motor skills like writing, buttoning, tying laces, history of present illness. The symptoms started at the age of 7 when her teacher first noticed her making mistakes while copying down sentences from the board. The mother slowly noticed the clumsiness and the imbalance while walking, addition to gaze abnormalities which went on progressing. Mrs. A could walk independently only till the age of 10. There was no history of seizures or bulbar or sphincter disturbances. And the family history of consanguineous marriage between first cousins is present. Again, this is important, hold that thought. And they did some investigations, PET CT scan, and there were some findings related to it. Next. Now, she actually suffers from cerebellar syndrome. Cerebellar syndrome can happen due to lesions or trauma, vascular occlusions, or tumors. And these signs and symptoms come together to collectively form a cerebellar syndrome. Now, I did speak about the morphological subdivisions of the cerebellum. I want you to keep that in your mind right now. And this is how you will remember and understand cerebellar syndrome. Like if the archicerebellum is involved, then we see truncal ataxia and staggering gait. So the person is walking, but with the legs spread wide out. Nystagmus, there is oscillatory movement of the eyeball. If the paleocerebellum is affected, then we see instability of the joints, flail joints, disturbance of tendon reflexes. We see pendular knee jerk, and this is an experiment we do in physiology. And ataxia, that is an inability to maintain balance while walking. Now, let me tell you, I'm doing this in brief, roughly, but a few days later, you will be doing this in a lot of detail. Ataxia is an umbrella term for a lot of other things. And this is when the consanguineous marriage part actually comes into play. Then you have neocerebellum. If this is affected, there's dysmetria, that is the inability to measure distance, and it's called past pointing, and it's tested by the finger-nose test. Intention tremors, which actually happens due to dysmetria. Adiadokukinesis, this is the inability to execute quick alternate movements. Like, for example, we do, this is pronation and supination. So if you ask the patient to keep doing this very quickly, he won't be able to do it. Again, there's dysarthria, scanning speech. In such cases, the person will speak, but he will stop at all the wrong places while speaking. And there's rebound phenomenon, so he cannot check the action of agonist and the antagonist muscles that correspond to each other. Now, the reason for this is there's a lack of coordination in totality. Then lesions in the body is in the same side of the brain, and decreased muscle tone is also observed. And yeah, this is a diagram I found showing everything that could possibly happen in the cerebellar syndrome. But the person can also have heart problems and basically trouble swallowing and eating as well. Slurred speech, tremors, difficulty in walking, all these things are observed. Okay, next. Now I'm talking about medulla oblongata. So medulla oblongata is essentially an upward extension of the spinal cord. So what happens over here is we see the organization of gray matters on the inside and the white matters on the outside. And again, this is going to play a very big role in when we study the internal structure of medulla oblongata. Next. From the external features, we can tell that the medulla oblongata is broken up into anterior aspect and the posterior aspect. So the anterior aspect has the pyramids, olives, rootlets of a variety of nerves, that is 9, 10, and 11th cranial nerve, and the inferior cerebellar peduncle. On the posterior aspect, we see the lower closed part and the upper open part. Now, I will demonstrate this to you in a diagram that I had. And in the lower closed part, we can see fascicular gracilis, fasciculus cuneatus, inferior cerebellar peduncle, and tuberous sinerum. In the upper open part, the median sulcus, hypoglossal and vagal triangle, vestibular area, area postrema, and stria medullaris. Next. Okay, so this is the anterior aspect of the medulla oblongata. We can see over here, we can see the pyramid, we can see the olives, and a variety of root nerve, spinal roots of cranial nerve, such as hypoglossal, accessory, vagus, and even the cranial roots of accessory nerve. This is our anterior aspect. Next. And this is our posterior aspect. So over here, I know the diagram's a little blurry, but it actually very nicely illustrates every single thing we wanted to see. On the left side, we can see the vagal and the hypoglossal trigone, which is the same as the triangle. Even the obex, which I didn't mention before, but we can see the obex. We can see the inferior cerebellar peduncle, along with the other cerebellar peduncles, which are slightly above it. Then when we move to the right, we see the fasciculus gracilis and the fasciculus cuneatus, along with the stria medullaris located right in the middle, as you can see, yes, the stria medullaris. And yeah, that's all the, and even the vestibular area right there. Okay, next. Now, when we talk about the internal features of the medulla oblongata, there are various decussations that are taken, I have four in total, in four different levels of the medulla oblongata. And each level is basically characterized by the most important feature over there. It's the level of decussation of pyramids. This is our first level. And over here, we see the nucleus gracilis and the nucleus cuneatus, nucleus of spinal tract, and we can even see the, we can see the spinal tract and the spinal nucleus of trigeminal nerve. We can see the pyramidal decussation right at the center. You can see fibers are crossing and making an X. This is our pyramidal decussation. Then we can see the pyramids, lateral spinothalamic tract, and spinocerebellar tract as well. Reticular formation is also there on either side, as we can see. Next. Now we see the level of decussation of the medial lemnisci, or this is also called the level of sensory decussation. There are 11 things happening in total over here. It's a lot to remember, but if we can club it into small pieces, it'll get better. The nucleus gracilis and nucleus cuneatus can be observed over here as well. Along with this, we can see the internal arcuate fibers and the spinocerebellar tract. This is all on the right. If we're able to see, the medial lemniscus is, we can see that's where the decussation is happening. Inferior olivary nucleus, pyramid, right at the bottom, the orange structure at the bottom, that's a pyramid. Reticular formation, and as I said that in the internal structure of the medulla oblongata, the gray matter is in the center and the white matter is on the outside. So right in the center, when we look at the gray matter, we have three nucleuses: nucleus tractus solitarius, nucleus dorsal nucleus of vagus, and hypoglossal nucleus. And on either side, we can see reticular formation once again. There's also medial longitudinal bundle and numerous other things, 11 in total, like I said, but I've gone over most of them. Next. Next, we see the level of decussation of the olives. Now, over here, there are, again, a large number of nuclei. So if you demarcate the nucleus separately and the rest, it'll get easier. In the dorsal vagal nucleus, the hypoglossal nucleus, it's located right below the fourth ventricle, as we can see. It's next to the yellow thing. Then, sorry, that yellow thing is nucleus of tractus solitarius. inferior cerebellar peduncle on the left, the nucleus ambiguous is located close to the center near the light blue and the dark blue thing. Now, this is actually the medial longitudinal fasciculus and medial lemniscus, what we see right in the center. The pink pyramid right at the bottom and the arcuate nucleus also at the bottom. We see the anterior spinocerebellar tract that is right at the left and on either ends, actually left and right, it's green in color. And the dorsal accessory olivary nucleus. We also see the inferior vestibular nucleus, that green portion right at the top. Trigeminal nerve nucleus and the spinal tract. Yeah, next. Okay. Now, there's also the level right inferior to the pons, but over here we see only two things, that is lateral vestibular nuclei and cochlear nuclei. When we speak about the functions of the medulla oblongata, it acts like the cardiac center, the vasomotor center, the respiratory center, and it also provides attachment to the last four cranial nerves. Now, this is something that we did see in the diagram, I think the anterior aspect diagram, we could see that over there. So, let's go on. Next. Yeah. This is the blood supply of the medulla oblongata. We see two vertebral arteries, anterior and posterior spinal arteries, anterior and posterior inferior cerebellar arteries, and basal arteries. So roughly these arteries come together to supply the medulla oblongata. Next. Yeah. So this is the diagram cumulatively showing everything in a blue. We have everything highlighted that essentially supplies blood to the medulla oblongata. The basal artery, all the arteries I just spoke about, the vertebral artery is very prominent. And the anterior superior cerebellar artery and the anterior inferior cerebellar artery. Even the posterior cerebral artery is there. And we can actually see this in correlation with the ones which may also supply the cerebellum. Next. So I have another case for you, which I think should demonstrate only one applied anatomy situation in the medulla oblongata. So the 50-year-old Mr. M was admitted with the complaints of sudden onset of dysphagia, dysarthria, with nasal voice and ataxia of the gait. So they examined him and the patient was conscious, well-oriented and cooperative. But the speech was dysarthric with nasal voice. Patient also had right-sided Horner's, loss of pain and temperature sensation on the right side of the face, 9th and 10th cranial nerve palsy on the right side and presence of cerebellar signs on the right side. There was loss of pain and temperature sensation on the left side of the body. All deep tendon reflexes and plantar reflexes were normal. Pulse, BP, heart and lungs were also normal. So they did some investigation and the CT scan of the brain showed an infarct on the right side of the medulla and a variety of other investigations. But I'll talk about the applied anatomy aspect next. So there's lateral medullary syndrome of Wallenberg and this is essentially what the patient had. Now this happens because of thrombosis of posterior inferior cerebellar artery. And because of this, we see a variety of symptoms like Horner's syndrome. He was suffering from Horner's syndrome and ipsilateral paralysis of muscles of palate, pharynx and larynx, which would explain the problems he had with his nasal voice. Ipsilateral ataxia of inferior cerebellar peduncle and cerebellum. And we also see ipsilateral loss of pain and temperature sensation over the face and contralateral loss of pain and temperature sensation over the trunks and the limbs. So these two are different. Next. And here we have a diagram very nicely showing ipsilateral Horner's contralateral alteration of pain and temperature sensation. Now this actually happens because the spinothalamic tract is affected and the basically we also see that there's ipsilateral sensory alteration of pain because the fifth cranial nerve is affected and ipsilateral cerebral ataxia. Next. The last disease, the second one rather, that we see is the medial medullary syndrome. This is also called Dejerine's anterior bulbar syndrome. Now this happens because of thrombosis to the vertebral artery. And here we see a contralateral hemiparesis of arms and legs, contralateral facial weakness if upper pons of medulla or midbrain is affected, And we see ipsilateral paralysis and even atrophy of half of tongue and contralateral loss of vibration sense and proprioception, essentially. And with this, we come to an end. Thank you.
Thank you so much, guys. We are done with the first topic for today's session. Now we're going to start with the second topic. Please start sharing the screen. Guys, all the doubts that you have, if any, you can ask them after both the topics are over, and we'll have time for that.
Ma'am, okay. Screen visible?
Yes.
Okay.
Perfect. Okay, I think we're going to start with Meghna, right?
Yes, ma'am, yes.
Hello, am I audible?
Meghna, you ready?
Yeah, am I audible?
Yes, yes, yes.
Okay, thank you. So okay, good evening, all. Good evening, all. I'm Meghna Visaria from JGMC Mumbai. Now we'll be talking about TRETs and pathways. TRETs are the neuronal networks. There are main two types of TRETs, ascending TRETs and descending TRETs. In ascending TRETs, we'll now be discussing anterolateral pathways. Next. So the basic organization of anterolateral pathways involves first order neuron, which starts from receptor cells, ends in dorsal root horn of the same side. Cell body of the first order neuron is located in the dorsal ganglion. Please note that the termination of the first order neuron is in the same side, that is ipsilaterally. The second order neuron starts from the dorsal root horn. Its fibers cross the midline to enter the opposite side, from where it ascends to the ventral posterolateral nucleus of the thalamus, that is contralaterally, on opposite side. Third order neuron starts from the nuclei of thalamus and terminates into the sensory area of the cortex 1, 2, and 3. So let's have a quick revision. Please type in the chat box, where does the first order neuron terminate?
Okay, I'm getting some questions. Someone says dorsal horn on same side.
I have made the setting. Everyone can chat with.
Okay, thank you. So the The first order neuron terminates in the dorsal horn on the same side. The termination of second order neuron. Yes, contralaterally in the thalamus. Termination of third order neuron. Yeah, cool. So now we'll move further and talk about the sensations carried by the TRETs. Next slide. Thank you all. So the sensations carried by the anterior pathway include crude touch, crude pressure, sexual sensations, rectal and bladder sensations, tickle and itch sensations, while that carried by the lateral pathway include pain and temperature. The receptors for the anterior pathway are free nerve endings, Merkel's tactile disc, while for the lateral pathway are free nerve endings and the thermal receptors. Next slide. Please note the difference between the anterior spinothalamic tract and lateral spinothalamic tract. They are present close to each other and are functionally different. Next. Yeah. So as we know by now that the pain sensations are carried by the lateral tract. Now, please observe the figure while I am telling you something. So pain is carried by the A delta and C fibers. A delta fibers are fast sharp pain fibers, while C fibers are slow chronic pain fibers. A delta fibers are included in neospinothalamic tract. They terminate in lamina 1. The second order neuron starts from there, the fibers of which pass to the opposite side to enter the anterolateral columns. C fibers, low pain fibers, are included in paleospinothalamic tract. They mostly terminate in second, third, and fourth order, fourth lamina, which are together known as substantia gelatinosa. This terminate mostly in the fifth lamina. The third order neuron starts from there, goes to the opposite side, and continues in the anterolateral pathway. Next slide. Yes, so as seen over here, most of pain fibers are carried to the somatosensory areas. Next. Okay, after having known how pain is detected by our body, we'll talk about how can we inhibit the pain right at the initiating level. So there are three major components of analgesia system which helps in inhibiting the pain. Periaqueductal gray area and periventricular areas in the mesencephalon and upper part of the pons. The first order neuron starts from there and terminates in the raphe magnus nucleus, which lies in the lower pons and upper medulla. From there, we have a third order neuron which terminates in the pain inhibitory complex in the dorsal horns of spinal cord. The first order neuron secretes enkephalin, while the neurons from raphe magnus nucleus secrete serotonin, and the third order neuron secretes enkephalin. Whenever pain is detected by the somatosensory areas, and these centers are excited, and the periventricular area starts passing impulses to the raphe magnus nucleus, from there to the enkephalin, from there to the pain inhibitory complex, and pain is inhibited by the system. Next. Okay, so now Harsh will continue. Thank you.
Can you guys hear me?
Yes, we can.
Okay. Hi guys, I'm Harsh, and I'm from Kasturba Medical College, Manipal, and I'll be talking about the dorsal column medial laminiscal pathway. So the dorsal column medial laminiscal pathway is the pathway that is responsible for transmitting sensations of touch, proprioception, and vibrations. Can we move on to the next slide? Yeah, so as I said, it's the pathway that is it mediates touch, vibratory sense, and proprioception. And it is also one of the longest, it's one of the longest CNS tracts in the body. As you can see, the fiber that goes from your great toe all the way up to the cortex is your longest nerve in the body. And the way that this pathway works is that the sensory fibers ascend ipsilaterally inside the, they ascend ipsilaterally via the spinal dorsal columns, and they go to the gracilis and the cuneate nuclei in the medulla. And once they reach there, the fibers will decussate. That means they cross over in the white matter and they go to the opposite side, and they finally ascend to the contralateral, or the opposite, VPL, that's the ventroposterior lateral thalamus, part of the thalamus. And from the VPL, they finally go to the primary sensory cortex, which is area 312 of Brodmann's areas. Next slide, please. Yeah, so the important thing that we have to remember in this particular pathway, as it's already been reiterated before, but I'll do it again. So the pathway is made up of three order neurons. The first order neuron is the one that goes from your posterior root ganglion to your nucleus gracilis or cuneatus, which is also the longest nerve of this tract. And the second order neuron is the one where it synapses at the nucleus gracilis or cuneatus and finally goes to the opposite thalamus. And the third order neuron is the one that starts from the opposite thalamus and goes to the sensory cortex, which is the Brodmann's area 312. And the level of decussation where the fibers cross over is at the in the medulla, and it's via the internal arcuate fibers. Yep. Next. Yeah. The way that these fibers are oriented inside the tract, or like inside the ascending tract, is that fibers from the lower half of the body, that means those fibers which are coming from the spinal cord, they will be positioned more medially. They will be present more medially inside the spinal cord. And those which are coming from the upper half of the body, which is your upper part, which is your cervical section, so your fingers, they will be present more laterally. And as the tract moves upwards, it's going to start to rotate inwards. And so when this happens, the foot end, or the lower body, is represented. So your foot end, which is the lower body, that those fibers go to nucleus gracilis, and the ones which are from your upper part go to your cuneate nucleus. And one way to remember is that the upper body, which comes from your cervical section, goes to the cuneate nucleus. So you have the two C's there, and the one that comes from your lower body goes to your gracilis nucleus. And once it starts to rotate in the spinal cord, the medial lemniscus, which is what it's called when it reaches the brainstem, it is organized from dorsal to ventral, which represents the neck to the foot. And we have one clinical correlate here, which is tibialis dorsalis. So could you guys type in the chat box the causative organism for tibialis dorsalis, if you know? Am I audible?
Yes, you are. Just give it 2 seconds. I think they're trying to.
Yeah.
Okay. Type the answer.
Yep. Okay. I can see the answers. Yeah. So you guys are correct. It is treponema pallidum, and treponema pallidum basically causes syphilis, and neurosyphilis is a late consequence of the disease, or the consequence of the infection. And it mostly happens in tertiary syphilis. And so what happens is that there is slow demyelination or degeneration of these neurons, especially of the dorsal nerve roots and also this column. And this results in a loss of proprioception, and you have a Romberg's positive in this case. Yeah. Can we move to the next slide? Yeah. So now we'll talk about the spinocerebellar pathway. And the spinocerebellar pathway, as you can like tell from the name, it goes from your spinal cord all the way to your cerebellum. Cerebellum, yes. Next. Yeah. So the spinocerebellar tract is responsible for it mediates your non-conscious proprioception. And basically what that means is that, for example, if you're sitting right now, you know that your knees are flexed, your back is extended. So this is non-conscious proprioception. That means you don't have to think about this. And so there are two different tracts which relays this information, and that is the dorsal, which is also the direct spinocerebellar tract. And there's the ventral, which is the indirect spinocerebellar tract. And the important thing to remember here, or there are two important features that we have to remember about this tract. And one of them is that this tract does not ascend to the cerebral cortex. So it ends in the cerebellum itself. Can you move to the next slide? Next slide, please.
Yeah, just a second. I'm doing it.
Yeah, no problem.
It isn't moving forward. Just a second.
Yeah, okay. Yeah. So the other important thing to remember about this tract is that the fibers of this tract, they decussate to the opposite side in the superior cerebellar peduncles. So when these fibers are entering the cerebellum via these peduncles, they will cross over. But once they reach inside the cerebellum, they will cross over again. And so the net result is that the fibers will still remain ipsilateral. That's why it's important to recognize that in cases of cerebellum lesions, the symptoms will appear on the same side of the lesion. And yeah, those are the two important things that you need to remember, is that this tract does not go all the way up to the cerebrum. It ends at the cerebellum, and the fact that it is an ipsilateral tract. Yeah. Next slide, please.
Yeah, okay. So I'm Bhavna, and I'll be taking up the descending tracts. Descending tracts are mainly the motor pathways of our body that are going to conduct the impulses from the brain to various... Okay, so am I visible? So the descending pathways, they are basically the motor tracts of our body, and they're going to conduct the impulses from our brain to various organs and the muscles to perform various functions. And this alters the balance of excitatory and inhibitory input that converge upon the alpha motor neurons, mainly by three mechanisms. They can either synapse directly on the alpha motor neurons, they can synapse directly on the gamma motor neurons, or they can synapse on interneurons, which act as switches that turns on and off, and that is under the control of the higher motor centers. I'm facing some network issues here, I guess. We'll take a second.
Yeah, yeah, not an issue.
Okay, so the descending tracts are mainly of two types. They're the pyramidal tracts and the extrapyramidal tracts. Pyramidal tracts include the corticospinal and the corticobulbar tracts, whereas the extrapyramidal tracts include rubrospinal and vestibular spinal, as well as the tectospinal tracts. So the pyramidal tract fibers to the spinal vertebral horn cells, and so they're known as the corticospinal tracts, whereas the corticobulbar tract fibers to the motor cranial nuclei, mainly the 5th, 7th, and the 12th, and that is when they're known as the corticobulbar or the corticonuclear tracts. Okay. So moving ahead. Can I just re-enter the meeting once?
Yeah, that's not an issue. If anyone else from your group also has the presentation and can present their screen, that will also work.
Can I present my screen?
Yes, yes, you can. Do you have access?
Yeah, yeah, I have. I think I do, yeah.
Perfect.
Just let me know. Can you see my screen?
Yes.
Okay, I'll just click on present. Okay, I think we were here, yeah.
Okay, I'm so sorry for the delay, guys. So I'll start right here. The pyramidal tracts are of two types, corticospinal, corticobulbar.
And the extrapyramidal tract include rubrospinal, vestibulospinal, and the tectospinal tracts. Next slide. Okay, so that is basically the arrangement of the tracts through the spinal cord. You can clearly see the lateral corticospinal tract, the anterior corticospinal tract. They basically develop from the decussation that happens at the medulla, which you'll be seeing in the next slide. Okay, so the tract originates from the pyramidal cells of beds in the motor cortex from the cerebrum, moves ahead down through the midbrain, the cerebellum, the medulla, and then for the decussates at the medulla. The 80 to 85% fibers are going to decussate here and form the lateral corticospinal tract, whereas the fibers that are not going to decussate, they will form the direct or uncrossed pyramidal tract. The other tracts that are going to originate from the vestibular nucleus will be known as the vestibulospinal tract. Those originating from the red nucleus will be called the tectospinal tracts, and from the superior colliculus will be called the tectospinal tract, whereas from the red nucleus will be known as the reticulospinal tract. Okay, next slide. Okay, so this is another slide that shows the pathway of the pyramidal tracts right here. As you can see, the tracts, 80 to 85% of tracts decussate in the medulla, which is visible on the screen. The other fibers also cross, also decussate, but it happens later in the spinal cord. And the fibers then lead towards the skeletal muscles, which they are going to innervate. Okay, next slide. This is the arrangement of the pyramidal tract fibers in the internal capsule. And the internal capsule is basically white fibers that are lying between the basal ganglia and are limited laterally by the lenticular nucleus that includes globus pallidus and the putamen, and anteriorly by the thalamus as well as the caudate nucleus. And they lie in the anterior two-thirds of the posterior limb of the internal capsule. Okay, next slide. Right, so mainly we'll be talking about lateral corticospinal tract, anterior corticospinal tract, and corticobulbar fibers. Lateral corticospinal tracts, they control the voluntary movements of the distal limbs, and they're concerned with fine, agile, and precise movements. For example, when we are buttoning our shirt. Whereas the anterior corticospinal tracts, they control muscles of the trunk and proximal portions of the limb. So they're responsible for the gross adjustments and the postural movements. Whereas corticobulbar fibers, they innervate the muscles of eye, face, tongue, and throat, and they help in the voluntary movements of muscles of head and neck. Next. Okay, so that is mainly the difference between the pyramidal and the extrapyramidal tracts. Pyramidal tracts include lateral corticospinal, anterior corticospinal, corticobulbar tracts. They are located in the precentral gyrus and they descend directly from the cerebral cortex. In this, 80% are going to cross medulla, whereas 20% cross in the spinal cord, and their function is fine movement. Whereas the extrapyramidal tract include rubrospinal, vestibulospinal, reticulospinal, and the tectospinal tracts. They originate in the brainstem nuclei, so there is no direct control of motor cortex. And three of them are going to cross except the vestibulospinal tract. And their main function is the control of body posture and the gross movements. Next. Okay, so we'll talk about the upper motor neuron and the lower motor neuron lesion. So before that, we must know what are the upper motor neurons and the lower motor neurons. The upper motor neurons, they are composed of neurons whose cell bodies are located in the brain or spinal cord, whereas the lower motor neurons have their cell bodies outside of brain and spinal cord. So in an upper motor neuron lesion, there is going to be a lesion above the anterior horn cell. Now it could be in motor pathway in cerebral cortex, internal capsule, cerebral peduncles, brainstem, or even spinal cord. Whereas in lower motor neuron lesions, the lesions are going to take place below the spinal cord. Yeah. So lower motor neuron lesion will lead to interrupt the spinal reflexes. Okay, so if we talk about the features of upper motor neuron lesion and the lower motor neuron lesion, The upper motor neuron lesion firstly will involve a group of muscles, whereas the lower motor neuron lesion will involve a single or individual muscle. In upper motor neuron lesion, the muscles will become spastic, whereas in lower motor neuron lesion, there will be flaccid paralysis. Now, if I talk about the Babinski sign, so it will be the Babinski sign will be elicited in the upper motor neuron lesion. Now, what is Babinski sign? You can see it in the next slide. Okay, so when you stroke the outer edge of your sole, the normal reflex, that is known as the plantar reflex, is the dorsiflexion. It is the plantar flexion of the foot and the toes. Whereas in positive Babinski sign, the toes are going to fan out, and this is the abnormal response that is elicited in upper motor neuron lesion. Okay, next slide. The lesion of pyramidal tracts lead to hemiplegia, and the commonest site for the lesions is in the internal capsule. That is going to lead to weakness or paralysis on the opposite side of the body, because most of the fibers they were crossing. It will lead to spasticity. Next slide. Now we can talk about it in two stages. The first stage being the acute stage, that is the stage of shock, where all the muscles of opposite side are going to be toneless. The movements of fingers, that is the fine movements, are lost. Movements like respiration and head and neck, they are retained. And if corticonuclear fibers escape injury, eyeball movements persist. Emotional movements remain intact, whereas all reflexes are lost. Next. Next is the stage of recovery, where the reflex activity returns. Affected muscles become spastic, so limbs are placed in an abnormal position. Tendon jerks are hyperactive and more sustained. Superficial reflexes are lost because they are mediated by pyramidal tracts. Spastic hemiplegic gait is observed, which is shown in the next slide. Yeah. So please take it to 35 seconds. Yeah. So this is your spastic gait, where the person moves as if their foot has been glued to the floor. Yeah. So that's it.
Hello. Yeah. So now we'll be talking about the special sensory pathways. And so we'll begin with the visual pathway first. The visual pathway starts from the retina, and it goes all the way to the occipital lobe of the cerebral cortex. And so, as you probably know, the retina consists of 10 different layers. And the last layer that's at the end of the retina is the ganglion cell layer. And so the ganglion cell layer, like the axons from these ganglion cells, they pass caudally or backwards in the optic nerve. So this here is the optic nerve. So I'll just clear some of the terminology first. So this is your field of vision right here. I don't know if you can see my cursor or not, but this is the field of vision that you have, represented by these blue and orange colors. And there's something called a temporal vision, and there's called a nasal vision. And you have your retina here, and the retina here is basically also divided into two different fibers, which is the nasal fibers and the temporal fibers. Once the optic nerve leaves each eyeball, it finally crosses over. There's a decussation, which is known as the optic chiasma or the optic chiasm. And from the optic chiasm, you have the optic tract, which runs backward, and it goes to the lateral geniculate body. And from the lateral geniculate body, it goes to the occipital lobe of this cerebral cortex. And you have to remember that the light which comes from the temporal field of vision will land on the nasal fibers and vice versa. So the ones that come from the nasal field of vision will land on the temporal retina. And in the optic chiasma, it's only the nasal fibers of both the sides that will cross over. And so once you reach the optic tract, each optic tract carries the vision from the opposite field of vision. So moving on. Yeah. So again, this is another diagram to explain the same thing. So you have your right visual field here, which is represented by the green part, and you have your left visual field, which is represented by the red part. And so if we talk about just one eyeball, let's say we're considering the right eyeball. So for the right eyeball, you can see that the light which comes from the nasal nasal field of vision for the right eyeball, it lands on the temporal retinum. And at the same time, the one that comes from the temporal field of vision, it lands on the nasal retina. And once these fibers travel in the optic nerve, the nasal fibers will cross over in the optic chiasm to the opposite side. And once they cross over, they go to the lateral geniculate nucleus. And from the lateral geniculate nucleus, they will further go on to the primary visual cortex, which is area 17 of Brodmann. Yeah, so now we will talk about some of the lesions of the visual pathway. And as you can see, this is a really nice simplified diagram that you can use to learn the different lesions that happen. So if you look at a lesion which happens here, a lesion that happens in the optic nerve which is coming out of each eyeball, if you have a lesion in at A, you will notice that it causes blindness in that entire eye. So if this eyeball is blocked out, you will lose all vision that is coming from one eyeball. If you have a lesion in the optic tract, which is at point C, you will lose vision in the opposite field of vision. That means that this kind of lesion will be called a homonymous, it'll be called a lesion in one optic tract will cause blindness in the other half of the visual field, and it will be called a homonymous hemianopia, which means that the same side of both the visual fields are lost and you will have a half blindness. So you can see here in figure C, which is the one given on the right side, you can see that for both the eyeballs, the vision is lost for the right side. Yeah, and if you talk about lesions which affect the optic chiasma, they will happen at point B. And in this, you can see that since both the nasal fibers are the only ones that are lost, because these are the fibers that decussate here, it will produce a heteronymous hemianopia, which means that heteronymous means that you lose opposite sides of the visual field. And so if you can see here at point B, you will only be able to see the nasal vision or the nasal field of view, whereas you will lose both of your temporal fields of vision. If you have any occipital lesions, which means that any lesions which extend from the lateral geniculate body all the way to the occipital cortex, these lesions will also present in the same way that a lesion would present in the optic tract. The only difference being that these regions will have macular sparing because the fibers that go to the macula are carried separately and they do not, they will not be present here, and so they will not get damaged in those lesions. And yeah, that's about it. You can move on to the auditory pathway.
Okay. I'll be taking up auditory pathway. Okay. So the axons of the spiral ganglion that innervate the hair cells from the cochlear division of eighth nerve, they're going to form the cochlear division. And then from there, the auditory nerve is going to enter the medulla and end in the dorsal and ventral cochlear nuclei. Then these were the first order neurons. Then the second order neurons from the cochlear nuclei, they end in the superior olivary nucleus and the trapezoid body. From there, the third order neurons, they pass up by a variety of pathways in the lateral lemniscus to the inferior colliculi. Then from the inferior colliculi, they're going to the medial geniculate body and finally to the primary auditory cortex, that is area 41 in the brain. We also have auditory association areas, that is area 22, 21 and 20. 22 being the Wernicke's area, that is mainly for comprehension. Okay, so again, this shows the same pathway, that from the cochlea, the fibers are going to go to the cochlear nucleus, then the superior olivary nucleus and the trapezoid body, further to inferior colliculus, then the medial geniculate body and the auditory cortex. Again, this is the same thing, so I think we can move further. So what are the disability of hearing is known as deafness. That literally means inability on a part of an individual to hear either wholly or partly. Next. Now, deafness, the type of hearing loss can be of two types, conductive or sensorineural. Conductive deafness means that the sounds are not conducted by the outer or the middle ear. So that means that the sound is not reaching the inner ear. So it causes reduction in the volume of sound and can be moderate to severe.
You can imagine it if the volume of your radio is turned like to really low. So you'll be able to hear it, but that the sound will be very low. Whereas in sensorineural deafness, the sound reaches the inner ear, but it is not relayed to the brain. That is, the brain cannot interpret the information. Now, it causes the loss of frequency and is often severe. Now, imagine listening to a radio that has not been tuned in correctly. So it is basically hard to make sense of the sounds. Next. Okay, so to check the hearing ability of an individual, we have several tests. The first one being the Rinne's test. What we're doing here is that the base of the vibrating tuning fork is placed on the mastoid process until the subject no longer hears it, which is the bone conduction, and then it is held in the air close to the ear of the patient. That is known as the air conduction. So in a normal individual, the air conduction is better than the bone conduction. That is, after you remove it from the mastoid process, the patient can still hear it, still hear the vibration. Whereas in conductive hearing loss, the patient does not hear vibration in air after bone conduction is over. In partial sensorineural hearing loss, air conduction is better than bone conduction. And in complete sensorineural deafness, hears no sound in both air and bone. Now, second test is the Weber's test. What happens here is that the base of the vibrating tuning fork is placed on the vertex of skull or the mandible. So if a normal person will hear the sound equally in both the ears, whereas in conductive hearing loss, the sounds are louder in the diseased ear. In partial and the complete sensorineural deafness, the sound is louder in the normal ear. Now, the third is the Schwaback test. What happened here is that the bone conduction is compared with that of the examiner, assuming that the hearing ability of the examiner is normal. Normally the bone conduction will be the same, whereas in conductive hearing loss, bone conduction will be better of the examiner. In partial, the bone conduction of patient is less than examiner, as well as in complete sensorineural deafness, bone conduction of patient is less than examiner.
Hello. Okay, so now we'll start with olfactory and gustatory pathways. Next slide. Next slide. Okay, so we'll start with olfactory receptors. Oh, previous one. So we will start with olfactory receptor cells. Olfactory receptor cells lies in the olfactory epithelium. The axons pass from the cribriform plate to the olfactory ganglion. Particular type of olfactory receptor cell terminates in that particular type of olfactory ganglion. Olfactory bulb consists of four types of cells: mitral cells and tuftate cells, the axons of which forms the olfactory tracts and projects to the olfactory cortex. Other two types of cells present in the olfactory bulb are peri-glomerular cells and granule cells, which are inhibitory in nature. Next slide. Okay. So olfactory tracts then divides into the lateral olfactory stria and medial olfactory stria. Lateral olfactory stria projects into anterior olfactory nucleus, olfactory tubercle, piriform cortex, entorhinal cortex, and amygdala of the brain. Whereas medial olfactory stria projects only into amygdala of the brain, which then projects into the hypothalamus. Thalamus receives sensations from olfactory tubercle, piriform cortex, entorhinal cortex, and amygdala, and passes it to the orbitofrontal cortex, where sense is perceived. Frontal cortex receives sensations from all parts of brain except anterior olfactory nucleus, which projects into contralateral olfactory bulb. Entorhinal cortex projects sensations to the hippocampus, whereas amygdala projects sensation to the hypothalamus. Next. Next slide. Now we'll be talking about gustatory pathways. Different nerve carries taste sensation from different parts of tongue and pharynx. All the nerves synapse in the nucleus of solitary tract. anterior one-third taste sensations are carried by caudate tympani nerve, which continues as facial nerve. Glossopharyngeal nerve carries taste sensation from posterior one-third, whereas vagus nerve carries taste sensation from pharynx. All these taste nerves terminate in the nucleus of solitary tract. From there, they project into the nuclear ventral posterior medial nucleus of thalamus. From there, the third order neuron starts and projects into the anterior insular frontal operculum, where taste sensations are perceived. Next. Next slide. So now we'll be talking about the clinical correlations. For the gustatory system, we have agusia and hypoagusia, which means absence and diminished taste sensations respectively. Injury to gustatory pathway neurons leads to them. Dysgeusia or paragusia. Perception of taste is different from the actual taste, which is due to temporal lobe epilepsy. Olfactory system, we have anosmia or hypoosmia, diminished or absence of taste of smell, damage to olfactory nerve or olfactory bulb, parosmia or dysosmia, distorted or perverted sense of smell. Lesion in temporal lobe or temporal lobe epilepsy leads to this. Thank you. Okay, so Kosha, we are done here.
Okay, great. Thank you so much, guys. Participants, if you have any questions, you can type them in the chat box. I'm opening that right now, or you can raise your hands too.
Kosha, I just
quoted. Yeah. I just saw. Guys, we'll wait for 2 minutes, I think, for you to type the questions or raise your hands if you have any doubts. Okay, we have a question for the first.